Well, good morning to my Blackhawk family. So glad to have you here today. If you don't know me, my name is Pastor Kevin. I'm pastor here, and we're ready to get to work. Anybody ready to join me? Either we've got some digging to do, or this is just in case anybody decides to take a nap. You can decide. This is going to come into play today because we're going to talk a lot about digging ditches. We're going to talk a lot about what it means to trust God and keep plowing, keep digging, keep going in your faith, even when you feel like quitting. Anybody ever been there before? So we're in a series of messages. We're in the second week now called Bold Faith in Uncertain Times. Anybody ever run upon those uncertain times before? We've all been there. We face those in every way around us. And if you're not facing some now, they'll probably come your way here very soon. And so just know today that you're not alone. Know today that even as we plow together, even as we dig together into God's Word and into the depths of our heart, that you're not by yourself, that God's got something for you. He's just getting started for your life. That's what we're looking at in this series. We're going through the life of Elisha. Now, last week we kicked off, and so we started this series by looking at the call of Elisha and how Elisha was called to follow Elijah. There's an Elijah. Everybody say Elijah. And then there is an Elisha. Everybody say Elisha. We're talking about the Elisha today. And so last week we looked at the fact that he just left everything, didn't he? He left everything to follow Jesus with his life. This is going to come back into play, just so you know. So hang in there with me. We're going to do some digging today into our God's Word and see what he has for you. Turn to 2 Kings, if you will, in your Bibles. I'm going to be reading from the ESV, English Standard Version today. If you want to follow along your app or whatever version you've got, follow along with us today. 2 Kings chapter 3, we're going to be looking at the first 20 verses. So I'm going to kind of breeze us through the first 10 verses, give you some context. Then we're going to go into those last 10 verses together. So in this series, we've been looking at how people in Scripture, particularly Elisha, have bold faith even when times around them are really uncertain. Even when everything around them is unstable, they served this stable stability in their faith, and they pressed on, they kept digging, they never quit, no matter what. How do they do that, you might ask? There are days where I feel that way, where I just can't dig another shovel full, and I have to tap into something that's bigger than me. And so here's the driving thought of this series. We'll say this every single week, and it's simply this, that we often ask God to do bold miracles through our faith, yet refuse to put ourselves in a position to need them. A lot of times we'll say, God, do the unexplainable. Do the impossible. Do a miracle in and through my faith, God. And then when God says, okay, we'll take this step, we say, well, no, I need to take a little bit more of a safe step than that, God. We refuse to put ourselves willingly in the positions where we need God to do the very things for which we pray for. And that leads us to the driving question, which is, how then can we position ourselves, how can we put ourselves in a position for God to do those miracles through our faith? And I love the story of Elisha because it's just real, it's raw. I love Elisha because I think I see some of my own tendencies in him, some of the sarcastic tendencies. We're going to hit a few of those today. Any sarcastic people in the building? I don't believe you. There's more than that. But I want to give you the bottom line. This is what we're going to look at today. Last week, we looked at bold obedience. We looked at what it means to take that big step, that bold calling that Elisha had within this idea of bold faith. Today's all about bold trust. Bold trust in 2 Kings chapter 3. The bottom line of today, the theme of this entire journey, because anytime you hear the word trust, I don't know if you're like me, I start thinking of the times where I didn't really want to trust. Those times that were the most uncertain, the times in my life where I really felt like I couldn't take another step, but I had to trust God anyway. And so if you're like me, maybe you're thinking of that. And here's the bottom line that we see in Elisha's life in this story, and it's that bold trust builds best. It builds the best during broken times. Bold trust builds best during broken times. You ever found any of those times before? Some of you brought those times in with you today, didn't you? We've all walked through them, but I've truly seen in my own life through experience and through looking at God's Word that really trust builds like no other time in our life when times around us are broken, when there aren't stable things, earthly things, things that we can do in and of our own strength that we can lean on, where we have to lean on something that's bigger than ourselves. And we're seeing that in Elisha's life. So let's look today. I want you to think about, let's everybody look within your heart for a minute. Everybody look at your heart. Let's talk to it for a minute, because I want to ask you to think about your biggest uncertainty in your life. What is it? Maybe it's a big need. Maybe it's a big problem. Maybe it's a bad relationship. I don't know what it is. What's the biggest uncertainty in your life right now? And just be honest with yourself. And what I want to challenge you to do, you ready for this? It's going to be tough. You thought you were coming just to sit and chill out while I did all the talking. But I'm going to bring you along a journey with me today. I need your help if we're going to get anywhere. You in with us? You ready? Ready to do this? What I want you to do is, as we look at this story today, listen to this message. Listen to what Elisha went through with the lens in mind of that greatest uncertainty in your life. Can we do that together today? Let's do it. Verses 1 through 9. I'm not going to read those verses, but it sets up a context of a story that a lot of times we kind of skim through and skim over in looking at the story of Elisha. And so going back to last week, Elisha killed the cows and burned the plows is what we said. Elijah came by and threw his cloak, which symbolized his calling, his authority, his anointing as a prophet of God. He threw it on Elisha, and Elisha burned the plow with which he plowed and killed the cows to feed those in the neighborhood, leave everything behind. In so doing, he essentially burned plan B. He buried and burned his plan B, his security, and his own agenda to follow after what God was doing in his heart and in his life. That's some bold faith. That's the kind of faith that God wants us to have. And then we know that Elisha served under. He served. It was characterized by surrender. He said, okay, I'll go. Sacrifice, I'm going to throw away all the things that I want for my life just to follow what I know what God wants. And then service, he served Elijah. A lot of times you think Elijah died in the chapters of the Bible. It looks like a year or two later, but it was 18 years later. And he went from managing his father's estate, if you will. They were rich because we know that they had 24 oxen. Those are like cars for us. So they're a 24-car family, if you remember that. He went from that to being a coffee runner, an unpaid intern, a servant to Elijah. He did that for 18 years. And then in chapter 2, a few things happened. He said, Elisha, what is it that you want? Anything you ask for, you can have. He said, I want a double portion of Elijah's spirit. All the stuff, God, that you've done in Elijah, double it. What a bold faith ask that he put forth there. And it's so interesting in Scripture. If you tally up the miracles that God had Elijah be a part of, God did the miracles. He just used mere men like Elijah and Elisha. Elijah was a part of 14 miracles. If you look at his story and his journey, guess how many Elisha is recorded as doing and being a part of? How about 28? Exactly double. I just love those things. That's no accident, folks. What God does in his word is on purpose, and it's powerful. He's regarded as being a part of more miracles in the Bible than anybody except for Jesus. Pretty powerful, isn't it? But Elisha, here's where he is. He finds himself leading in uncertain times. Here are a few things going on. The kingdom of Israel, where they were a prophet, Elijah and Elisha, it's divided. It's coming off the horrendous reign of Ahab and Jezebel. And they were chasing after trying to kill Elisha's mentor, Elijah. Moab is now revolting against Israel. They're way out of line. They have to be dealt with. There's going to be some war that has to take place to get things back on track, to establish an already divided kingdom, to kind of get some stability back in place that was much, much needed. Baal worship was very big during this time, where false gods were left and they were right. There was confusion religiously. There was confusion financially. There was confusion and uncertainty abounding everywhere. So three kings team up. Here's what happens. Moab has rebelled against Israel. Three kings team up. The northern kingdom, the southern kingdom of Israel, that's two, then the king of Edom. They team up and say, let's go deal with Moab. So they're on a march, they're on a mission, and they think, you know, it's three against one. We kind of have them outnumbered. This should be pretty simple. Ever had those seasons of your life where it seems like things should go one way and there's no way it could go any other? But then unexpected stuff happens. So that's where they are. And in verse 8, these three kings have teamed up, and the question becomes, what route do we take? We're going to go attack Moab. What route do we take? And somebody speaks up and says, you know, I know a shortcut. You ever seen that happen before? You ever seen the shortcuts become long cuts? That's kind of what's about to happen, just to give you a little foreshadowing. And they say, well, we know a route, and it's through Edom. And the king of Edom, their people were all together. They knew the land. They knew where they were going. So they had it made. It's three against one. What could go wrong? So their plan was this, to go and replenish with water. And this is so key. Don't miss this. In verse 9, their plan is to stop at this brook called the Brook of Karak. They've been marching seven full days, verse 9, in 1 Kings 3, 2 Kings 3. They're tired, and they knew that there was a stream that came from the mountains there. Now, this stream had been nicknamed the stream that never runs dry. It was a sure thing. They knew they would have to stop there, replenish their animals, all three of these armies. Then they could march in to Moab, kind of a sneak attack from the back door. It was set. But guess what happens in verse 9? The stream that never runs dry had run dry. Have you ever been there in your life before? The sure things, the streams that never run dry, the things that you know you can depend on, they start to break and they start to crumble, and this life that you thought was built on a pretty good foundation has now become like sinking sand, and it's up and it's down, and the things you were once confident in, you're no longer confident in, and the things that you had planned on didn't go that way, and everything started to crumble and fall apart all around. You ever been there? Well, that's where these guys were. And I love, by the way, if that's you, sometimes we're bad about saying, yeah, we've been there. And it's good to know that we're there together, but there's hope. I love Isaiah 43, verses 18 and 19, where God tells you, and Jesus looks at you today and says, I will make a way in the wilderness you call your life. I will put streams in the desert of your life to do whatever new thing I so choose to do. God wants to do something in you today, and he'll do whatever it takes to put a river in the desert to make a way in the wilderness, the uncertainty that is your life. So here's the question we're going to answer. How can I then, this is where they are, the unexpected has happened. Everything fell apart. How can I trust God when the unexpected happens? You ever asked that one before? How can I trust God when the unexpected happens? And here's what I know about you. You say, you don't know me. You're right, but I know you're a person that has struggles and unexpected things just like me. I know that we're all in one of three boats when it comes to the unexpected in life. Number one, I know that you are either, and it could be a combination, by the way, you're either coming out of unexpected things happening in your life, or you're in the middle of the unexpected things happening in your life, or you're going into the unexpected things happening in your life. At least one of those three is true of you and me. We're all in this together. Some of you say, I feel like all three is happening at once right now in this moment. All three of those things, I'm in the middle of it. I just came out of one thing. I'm in the middle of another, and I'm going into the next one all at once when those unexpected things happen in life. But there's a couple of things, two big principles that I think give us some answers to that question. How can I trust God when the unexpected happens? Number one, believe big. Believe big. Everybody say, believe big. Believe big. If you're taking notes, write that down. Big. Write it big and bold. Believe big. When the unexpected happens, we tend to do one of two things. We either tend to kind of blame God, or we tend to maybe get driven to our faith and maybe believe God a little bit more. Here's what we have beginning here in verse number 10 of 2 Kings chapter 3, is we have two kings. We have Joram, and we have Jehoshaphat, and both of them give an example on both ends of the equation. One tends to kind of blame God, one tends to kind of believe God. I think both were completely overwhelmed. They're exhausted, they've marched 7 days, they're facing sure death. Think about this. They're on enemy territory. They're right on the brink of the enemy's territory. They're dying of thirst. They have three full armies with them. They are supposed to be leading these armies, and they're getting nowhere. They're hurting and confused. And life is very uncertain. The unexpected has happened. And so let's look at verse number 10, and we'll see the first reaction. But I hope for you, as we read this, you'll see two ends of the equation. I hope maybe for some, you can shift today from the blame God mindset to the believe God mindset. We've all been in all of those different places. Who's ready for the word this morning? Verse 10, then the king of Israel said, "Alas, the Lord has called these three kings to give them into the hands of Moab." That's the blame God mentality. We'll go a verse at a time through all of these. The blame God mentality, and we see that happening right here. There's a Hebrew word for that word, alas. Some versions may say, what? Everybody say, what? You ever been there? Where you enter this new season of your life and all you can do is say, what are you doing, God? There's the Hebrew word for the word alas, or what? I'm going to put it on the screen for you. It really doesn't matter how you pronounce it. This is what it looks like. That's how we would spell it. So you say, aha. That's not what he meant. Here's what I know about that. That's the how we would write out the Hebrew word for that word alas. But here is how there's an English pronunciation. Are you ready? You'll know this one. It's pretty deep theologically, but I'm pretty sure we can all get there at the same time. You ready to see it? This is the English word. Ah! Everybody say, ah! You ever had those moments? Yes, we have. That is, and here's what that word really means. If you look at what that word, alas, what it means is it's a shout from deep within, which is forcefully punctuated with pain, fear, and bone-trembling disbelief. That little simple, ah, means a lot more sometimes in our life, doesn't it? When the unexpected happens. Plans shatter, and all I can do is scream. That's kind of where we're at in this story. I want to give you a statement. I believe this with all of my heart, that broken times, we said that bold faith builds best, bold trust builds best during broken times. I believe that broken times become blessings when they drive us to depend on God. It doesn't feel that way some days, but I truly believe that because I've seen, as a pastor and as a person, I've seen what difficult times, broken times can do in people's lives. It'll do usually one of two things. It drives you to your faith, or it drives you from your faith. We have two kings here. We just heard one being kind of driven from his faith, from what maybe it should have pointed him to. And then we see a different turn of events here where we see in verses 11 and 12, we have a response that's kind of like, wait, we do have a prophet of God. Maybe God has something he wants to say in the middle of all this. Pretty good response, I'd say, when broken times come. Look at verse 11 with me. That was Joram's response. He tended to blame God. Now Jehoshaphat comes in, and he at least somewhat believes God. Like, let's at least hear from God. Verse number 11. Jehoshaphat said, "Is there no prophet of the Lord here through whom we may inquire of the Lord?" Then one of the king of Israel's servants answered, "Elisha, the son of Shaphat, is here, who poured water on the hands of Elisha." He served Elijah. Verse 12, and Jehoshaphat said, "The word of the Lord is with him." So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat and the king of Edom, all three kings, went down to him. We saw a shift from blame God to at least somewhat believe God. Some of you are in the crux of that decision in your own life. Let me ask you, how long do we often sit in the blame God camp until we finally say, I'm just going to choose to believe God's bigger than this stuff, and I'm just going to ask him what's going on? And so they wanted to go to Elisha. Now, Jehoshaphat, the word inquire, when he says, let's inquire of him, I want to tell you what that word means. It's more than just, hey, let's just go ask him. Let's just go ask him. It means to seek deeply. Write that down if you're taking notes. To seek deeply. To go and truly hear from God. What's happening here? They have seen Elisha do a lot of miracles. They've definitely been watching Elijah. They've seen what God's been doing through them. Most of these people, and we're going to talk about it more in a moment, they've gotten really far from God, but they've seen God work through these people. And it's kind of like, well, hey, he's done a lot. God's really blessed his ministry. Let's get Elisha to do a little rain dance. And he'll do a rain dance and it'll rain. Let's at least just go ask. Let's at least go see if God wants to do anything here. And you think about what Elisha has been doing. He's really in his rookie year, if you will, of being a prophet. I love this. And this is where I start to identify a little bit with Elisha. He's in his rookie year of being a prophet. He had split a river. He's healed poison water. He's been a part of all these great things. But my personal favorite, if you go back to 2 Kings chapter 2, you don't have to flip there. We don't need to preach this sermon. I'm just telling you, you should read your Bible. There's some interesting stuff in there. Because my personal favorite is Smokey and the Bears. And if you have read his story, you'll know what I'm saying in a minute. Because at the end of 2 Kings chapter 2, these boys, Scripture says, came out and they were poking fun at Elisha, calling him Baldy. Hey, Baldy, go on up the mountain. Hey, Baldy, hey, Baldy. And so maybe in a weak moment, Elisha curses them in the name of the Lord, and two bears come out of the woods and devour 42 kids. It's there. You should read your Bible. I'm telling you, this is good stuff. This guy has an attitude. You say, what do we learn from that? Well, I don't know totally, but I can tell you a couple of things that we should learn from it. And I'll just say, some of you who should remain nameless that sit over in this area, a few rows behind me, have noticed something happening back here. No, I'm not turning around. I know we got cameras everywhere. I'm not going to try to show you right now, but I've heard. And they've said, hey, I noticed something happening back here. All I'm going to say is you saw what happened when those boys made fun of a balding guy. And if you keep making fun of me, this guy may come after you. That's all I'm going to say. I'll leave it there. Elisha and the bears. What an attitude. What a real guy. What a low moment, perhaps. There's a lot more to that story. We're not preaching that one now, but this is who you're dealing with. This is where Elisha is in his life. And I'm going to tell you something that I've even practiced this week that'll help you if you have ever entered a time of discouragement or disappointment or disillusionment. I believe that sometimes the best remedy for discouragement is to just simply remember the faithfulness of God. I wonder how many times Elisha had to do that in the midst of mistakes, in the midst of the shortcomings in his life, in the midst of the moments like this where times are uncertain and he's frustrated, and we'll see that here in just a moment, that he just had to go back to the miracles God had already done. Even just this week, I sat with a dear friend and brother, and we just did that together. We just talked about some of the stuff that God had done in our life, and it helped us kind of begin to overcome some of the discouraging parts of our life that are happening right now. Just so you know, I have those too. You have those too. We're all in those moments together. I have high days and low days and everything in between. But one of the best remedies for that discouragement and disappointment is just to simply stop and say, God, you've been so faithful to me, and here's how. Maybe for you, your homework this week is to go write down how God's been faithful to you. Make a list and see how good the Lord is. A lot of times we start to learn it's not quite as bad as I've been making it out to be in my life. Let's go to verse 13 and verse 14. Here's where we see a little bit of sass, a little bit of sarcasm from Elisha. Look at verse 13 with me. They had inquired of him there. They decided, we're going to seek deeply. We're going to hear from God. And Elisha said to the king of Israel, what have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and to the prophets of your mother. That's good. We'll get back there in a minute. You don't see the humor yet, but I'm going to draw it out in a minute. But the king of Israel said to him, no. It is the Lord who has called these three kings to give them into the hand of Moab. And Elisha said, all right, he gives in here. As the Lord of hosts lives before whom I stand, were it not that I have regard for Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, I would neither look at you nor see you. So he makes this decision. Okay, well, I'm going to talk with you about this. And I love that there's some sarcasm in there. And here at Blackhawk, and I personally 100% believe that the Word of God is completely infallible. It's the Word of God without error. It's His Word to you and to me. But if there was one thing that could have been left out, and it wasn't, because God knows better than me, I'm just here to tell you, I think that the listing of spiritual gifts, sarcasm should have been on that list. And it's not, because people use it wrongly. But I know I have that gift. I think Elisha has that gift. And I love that he's really following in the footsteps of Elijah. You look back at Elijah's story, Elisha's really bringing out the two bears attitude here. The two bears attitude's coming out here because he's saying, you know what? I don't want to help you. He pulls out the yo mama jokes. He says, yo mama has some prophets, go talk to them. I'm not helping you. And I love, because when you go back to the story of Elijah, when he battles the prophets of Baal, Now, if you remember that story, he was far outnumbered, and they were supposed to make fire, and their gods were supposed to make fire, and it was this big competition, and Elijah was far, far, far outnumbered, but he served the one true God, and so the one true God and Elijah won that battle. But I love how he taunts the prophets of Baal in the midst of that. He says, I don't know, maybe you should scream louder. Your God must be asleep. Read it. It's in there. I love it. He says, well, maybe they're just taking a nap. Maybe your gods just went on vacation. Scream a little louder. They can't quite hear you. Scream a little bit louder. The spiritual gift of sarcasm all over Elijah's life. He says, well, maybe they've gone to the bathroom. They're just taking a leak. Scream louder. Maybe you'll get them out. That didn't say that. That's the NKV, New Kevin Version. Don't buy that Bible. It's not any good. Buy his. But I love that they're real, they're raw, and they're just battling through life every single day. And we see that even in Elisha's life. And I love in verse 15, look there with me, where he says, all right, let's do this. He says, now bring to me a musician. And when the musician played, the hand of the Lord came upon him. I love that too, because it's like, go get me some mood music. How many of you, when times get tough, you put the headphones on? I'm that way. Let's tune it out. Just put on, you know, depending on what the mood of the day may be, that's how I choose the music. You ever been there? We just put on the mood music. I love that, and this was not an uncommon practice for prophets, that you see, because they would have a harp come and play, but I love that it's like, go get me some of the biggest, some versions even say, go get me a harp, and like, go get me the biggest, most difficult to move instrument you can find and bring it, and then I'm going to tell you what God has for you. But it wasn't an uncommon practice, and then now we're going to hear from the Lord. But what we saw is a believe big shift. We saw a shift from let's blame God and say, God, you just brought all three of our armies, all three of these kings here together to be slaughtered, to let's at least seek deeply and inquire of what God has to say in this moment. Even when it makes no sense, God, we're going to choose to believe big enough that we'll hear from you. So believe big. Number two, start small. Everybody say, start small. Believe big, verses 10 through 15, but in the last verses we'll look at, 16 through 20, we see this idea of just simply starting small. Look at verses 16 and 17 with me. And he said, thus says the Lord, I will make this dry stream bed full of pools. Remember, the river that never runs dry, the stream that never runs dry, is as dry as a bone. But God says, I'm going to make it full of pools. I'm going to fill it with water. Verse 17, for thus says the Lord, you shall not see wind or rain, but that stream bed shall be filled with water so that you shall drink, you, your livestock, and your animals. Now, what you should see is, depending on what version you're reading here, the real text here is he says, not just that I'm going to fill this dry stream bed, but I'm going to ask you to do something before I fill it. The New King James Version even says, make this valley full of ditches. So he's saying, pick up a shovel, go dig a ditch, go to work, do something that makes no sense at all, and I'm going to bless you beyond belief. He's saying, go to work. He's saying, take a step of faith. Trust me with this bold trust that you don't feel like you can get to on your own. Pick up your shovel, go to work, and I'm going to work in and around your life. That's where we're at in this story. And so what I want to challenge you with is this idea that sometimes in our faith, only God can send water. Only God can send relief. But sometimes he just wants you to be faithful where he's planted you. Sometimes he wants you just to pick up the shovel once again that you've picked up over and over again. Keep choosing to dig. Keep choosing to trust. Keep choosing to show up at that workplace that you're tired of going to and ready to run away from. Keep choosing to go to church. Keep choosing to pick up that Bible. Keep choosing to pray to a God that sometimes feels like he never hears you. Keep choosing to dig the ditches in your life spiritually so that God can bless through your work, through your faithfulness. And I love when God shows up and blesses with his faithfulness through my bold faith. Some of you came today so that God could remind you just to pick up the shovel one more time. Don't quit because everybody around you is quitting. Don't quit just because you feel like you have no energy left in the tank. Don't quit. Don't stop. Keep digging. Keep digging, because God will never, ever fail you. Even when you are faithless, He is faithful. Even when you have no energy, He will give you the strength to pick up the shovel and keep digging. Some of you came today because you need to pick up your shovel and keep digging. There's something about picking up a shovel, though. Sometimes to dig the ditches that God's asking you to dig in your life, it also means digging a hole over to the side and burying some things. Sometimes you're not going to be able to keep digging the ditches that God's going to fill with the water that you feel will never, ever come until you're willing to bury some things, put them to rest, put them away, and trust God with the present and not be held back by your past any longer. Some of you today need to take that shovel. You can't even get to the ditch digging part yet because we got to dig a little hole. So dig you a hole, put those chains of your past in the hole, bury them, and get to digging the ditches of faith that God's called you to dig. And when you do that, that's when bold trust, even in the middle of broken times, will take root in your life in ways that not just will change your life, but God will use to change the lives of other people and change the whole world around you. Yes, I'm talking to you. Somebody's in here saying, that's nice, but I'm too far gone to dig a ditch. No, you're not. God's just getting started with you. He may be waiting on you to bury something. He may be waiting on you to just take a step of faith. And I'll tell you this, I love this thought and this story, is just simply allow your faith to give way to God's faithfulness. Allow your faith to give way to God's faithfulness in your life. And I want to ask you a question. Write this down if you're taking notes. What ditch is God asking you to dig? I want to challenge you to answer that question. As you allow your faith to give way to God's faithfulness, what ditch is God asking you to dig? What step of faith? Maybe it's to just trust Him with a diagnosis that you've received. Maybe it's to reach out to that person that you've been estranged from. Your relationship has been broken for quite some time, and it's time to fix that relationship. It's time to call those people and mend and build some bridges that you never thought you would ever choose to mend and to build. Maybe it's to start tithing, to start giving of your funds, being a part of what God's doing as a step of faith. There's a reason God talks about that so much. Maybe it's to simply go to work tomorrow when you thought you were going to stay home. Maybe it's to plug your family back into the church, and maybe you've been hurt in the past by the church. We've probably all been there at some point, and I have such a heart for people who we would say, you know, people that are unchurched, people that just don't go to church. But there's also another group of people that I call the de-churched. The de-churched, it means you used to be plugged in, but stuff happened, people showed up in the church, and you decided, I'm not doing the church thing anymore. For some of you, the ditch you need to dig is, I'm going to re-engage with God's church, and I'm going to start basing what my faith is all about, not on the people of God, but on God Himself. Because I want you to know, people will always fail you. I will fail you. I strive to lead for Jesus every single day, and that's my commitment as your pastor, is to make sure that everything that I do, to the best of my ability, hopefully beyond that, with His ability, leads us to His future. But if you put your eyes on me, I will fail you. So Jesus says, fix your eyes on me. I'm the author and the finisher of your faith. So base your faith on Jesus, not on the people who try their best to follow Him. And maybe that's the ditch that you need to dig today, is just say, I'm going to follow Jesus and base my faith on Him and on Him alone. Big faith, bold faith, it believes big things, but it starts with the small steps. It believes big things, but starts with small steps. I love in this story, verses 18 and 19. Look there with me. It's my favorite verse in the whole passage, I believe, verse 18. After He says He's going to fill this dry stream bed with all of these pools of water, verse 18, this is a light thing in the sight of the Lord. This is a light thing in the sight of the Lord. Let me speak to those of you who still hadn't believed what I've been preaching. Some of you are still looking at me like this. Like you're not sure if you can truly buy into this yet. Don't buy into it because I'm preaching it with passion or preaching boldly. Buy into it because bold faith screams what verse 18 says about your life, and it is, this is a light thing for the Lord. The things that feel the heaviest in our life are just tiny grains of sand to the God who created you. He's just getting started in your life. It's a light thing for the Lord. These impossible things that we face, the things that make it so hard to trust God when the unexpected happens, they're light. They're teeny tiny little grains of sand compared to what God can do in your life. This is a light thing in the sight of the Lord. He will also give the Moabites into your hand, and you shall attack every fortified city and every choice city, and shall fell every good tree and stop up all springs of water and ruin every good piece of land with stones. The next morning, verse 20, the next morning, about the time of the offering of sacrifice, behold, what do you think happened? God delivered. God delivered. And he always does. And he always will. Behold, water came from the direction of Edom till the country was filled with water. There's more to this story, but it ends exactly as God says it's going to end. He did exactly what he said he was going to do. But I love that these armies that are here, they're estranged from God. They used to watch God work, the God, the one true God, Yahweh, they call him. They watched God work. They used to look at God as their father. Most of these people in these armies, but they've either started worshiping false God in Baal, or they've gotten off track because the kingdom is divided. And I think about our nation. I think about you and me. I think about where the church is today. We're a lot like them. They used to know, but now they've gotten off track. These very people in this circle and all of these armies have been estranged from God. They've been de-churched, if you will. They used to get it, now they don't. They're off track and they don't know where to turn. But then they're seeing this prophet of God promise a miracle that only God could do and say, this is a light thing in the sight of God. And that's what I want this church. That's what I believe the church that Jesus is building and said, even the gates of hell can't prevail against it. That's what we should be in a dark world. We should be the light of life, the light of Jesus in this dark world that screams and says, even the impossible things, bringing together people that are in all different shapes, all different forms, all different beliefs, all different backgrounds, bringing people together because only Jesus can do that. We should be that same light in this world around us. That's the light thing inside of God. Only he can do it. That's what the church is supposed to be, folks. That's what bold trust can look like in this life. You can be that in someone's life. You. God's just getting started with you, and it's just going to start with a shovel full. How do you dig a ditch? I've dug a few in my time. Learned good work ethic right off the bat. The Rivers family, you learn to work or you don't eat. How do you dig a ditch? One shovel full at a time. If you feel like there's a mountain of dirt in front of you today, start with a shovel full. With a gust of wind from the breath of God, he can knock that mountain down. He just wants you to dig one shovel full at a time. Put one foot in front of the other and say, God, I'm yours. I trust you with boldness. I want to ask you just to close your eyes for a moment. Nobody look around. As we prepare to sing in just a moment, we're going to sing a great song when it comes to faith. We've talked about how bold faith, bold trust builds best in broken times. We're going to sing this song called It Is Well. It Is Well. There's been many times in the church setting I've sung this song. I've sang It Is Well, but it really wasn't well. And it was just a fake thing that I was supposed to do, a ritual I was supposed to go through. My prayer is that today in this place, maybe for the first time ever in your life, for some of you, you can sing It Is Well because God has done a work inside of you that only he could do because you said, I'm going to start shoveling one shovelful at a time. And if you know Jesus today, you've got a personal relationship with him today, what's that one shovelful he's asked you to dig today? What's that one step of faith that he's called you to take? I challenge you to think about what that looks like, but I want to speak particularly to those of you who would say, my shovelful, my first step of faith is to enter into this kind of relationship that you're talking about. Believe big and start small. Starting small means I've got to trust Jesus to save me. I've never truly done that, Watch that guy get baptized earlier. Watch Tim take that step of faith. I need to take that step of faith. Some of you need to be baptized because you've already been saved, but some of you today would say, I just need to know that I am saved. I just need to know that I have a personal relationship with God because I've trusted Jesus as my Savior. I'm full aware that a lot of times we use words like that in the church, and it's hard to make sense of them. So I'll do my best to do just that for you, and it starts with this idea that it really is as simple as Jesus says it is. Stop making it complicated. I believe somebody here today in this room, you've been making it so complicated and saying, I've got to take this step or that step and then I can trust Jesus. Don't do that. That's a lie of the enemy. You will never get to that place until you just say, I'm going to take that leap of faith. I plead with you, don't wait another day. Salvation starts with believing Jesus died. When he died on that cross, he paid a price for your sin. After he lived a sinless life that you definitely can't live and I definitely can't live, he did that. He accomplished that. But he died on the cross to pay the price for your sin, because the price of our sin is death. It's eternal death. But Jesus came and he paid that price by being nailed to that cross for you and for me. And he died. But the beauty is he rose again and he's alive today. He is alive today. And the Bible promises, the Word of God promises, God looks at you and you're right into your soul today and says, if you will believe that with all of your heart, you shall be saved. Not if God's in a good mood that day, you'll be saved. Not if you've taken some other steps first, you'll be saved. Not if nothing. No, you shall be saved. It really is that simple. It really is that true. And I challenge you just to take that leap of faith. It looks as simple as just saying, Jesus, this life's been mine, now it's yours. I do believe those things, and I give you me. I'm not going to lead you in a time of prayer because of your heart screaming something like that right from your own heart to God in your own words in this moment. If that's you, would you please just take this moment with bold trust and give your life to Jesus? Would you do that right now?